cuta utataka nitakupama. Hey guys, welcome back to our channel. It's your girl Fanny Lungu, back with another reaction video. If you're new to this channel, make sure to give this video a thumbs up, share it with your friends, and of course do not forget to subscribe. Today I'm going to be reacting to why Europe feared the most, the true history. So a big shout out to the person that suggested this. Without wasting time, let's get into the video.
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته and welcome to our first episode of this exciting journey through the history of Islam in the world. Now we're going to start first of all with the continent which is the closest to the Muslim world, although people might not look at it that way, but it is Europe. Of course, Islam, and not only, many monotheistic religions, if not all of them, actually started in the Middle East. But the effect the Middle East, seeing that the location of that Middle East, obviously the Middle East is close to Europe, the location, of course, influences the development and the history of Europe and the connection between Islam and other monotheistic faiths and the Europeans. Number one, the first episode would like to go deep into the history of one very important region, one very important part of Europe, which was the first one to be opened to Islam. And I use consciously the verb to open as it is used in Arabic. I don't want to use the word conquer because a conquest and to conquer something brings a lot of negativity with it, a lot of negative luggage. And I would like to insist to using the word open because not always the Muslims had to fight to open a place, but many times the Christian inhabitants or non-Muslim inhabitants opened the doors to them, and many times the non-Muslims accepted Islam, and many times they actually became Muslims and fought with the Muslims against outside forces or enemies. So that's why the term conquer, to conquer, is not really the best term in that case. So we will use the term to open. In the case of the first period of Islam in Europe, the first period or the first time that the Muslims actually arrived in Europe and brought Europe further deeper into Europe was the period of Al-Andalus. And we will have to distinguish here between Al-Andalus as a geographical term but also as a historical, as a chronological term. Now, let me make this clear. First of all, Al-Andalus contains as a geographical part of the world, it used to be the countries that are nowadays Spain and Portugal. So the Iberian Peninsula, as well as Gibraltar, which is nowadays British territory. So we're looking at the Iberian Peninsula going, starting somewhere in Gibraltar, incorporating, of course, countries like Portugal, Spain, up to France, up to the south of France. So that used to be the part that that the Muslims used to call Al-Andalus, geographically. Chronologically, Al-Andalus started at 711 from the moment that Tariq bin Ziyad, the first Muslim, the first Berber, and not Arab, the first Muslim, the first Berber, the first African to set foot in Europe and to establish Islam in Europe. He arrived 711 in Gibraltar, and that's why Gibraltar, by the way, is called Gibraltar, because it comes from the Arabic Jibr at-Tariq, so the mountain, the hill of Tariq, Tariq bin Ziyad. So mashallah, again, to our Muslim, to our Arab brothers, Tariq bin Ziyad was a Berber. Why I'm insisting of mentioning it is simply because either this is not mentioned at all in the Arab world, or many people even believe in the Arab world that Tariq bin Ziyad was an Arab. Now, in our case, as Muslims, obviously that is not important if somebody was an Arab, an African, a Greek or a Turk. The Berbers are actually the indigenous population of Africa, of North Africa. And the Arabs came, of course, from the Arabian Peninsula, and they exported Islam with them, no doubt about it. They exported the faith with them. They exported the language with them, of course, the Arabic language. However, It was not that they forced the Berbers who were living in North Africa to accept Islam. The Berbers, it took them around 10 to 20 years to, as Berber people, to accept the faith, which they did willingly. And once they accepted the faith, what happened? The Berbers took Islam from Africa into Europe. This is a massive and a very important point to mention here. It was not the Arabs, as people keep saying, or the historians even mention nowadays, the Arabs came to Europe, the Arabs came to Spain, to Portugal and to Europe, and they spread Islam. Islam spread in itself. So it was something that many people in the Iberian Peninsula, as it's called, Spain and Portugal, this peninsula is called the Iberian Peninsula, they themselves accepted Islam. Many of the indigenous people living in Spain and Portugal at that time, Christians, most of them accepted the faith, became Muslim. Jews who were living there accepted the faith because they saw that when the Muslims came, the taxation system was much fairer and much better than of the people who were before on the Iberian Peninsula, which were actually, it was a Germanic tribe, the Goths, the Eastern Goths. So these Gothic people conquered the Iberian Peninsula, and they gave actually the indigenous people a hard time there, and the Jews especially. And they saw that when the Muslims came, alhamdulillah, they gave them the possibility to worship the way they wanted to worship. And many of them, as I said again, accepted Islam. Also, many Jews followed Tariq bin Ziyad and followed the Muslims. Either they helped them to get rid of the Goths from the Iberian Peninsula, or they themselves accepted Islam and became part of the Ummah, mashallah. When these Visigoths, the Germanic tribe, was ruling the Iberian Peninsula, what became later Al-Andalus, a certain ruler named Redric or Rodrigo, he was ruling the Iberian Peninsula, had an opponent, Julian, who was loyal to the former ruler, the previous ruler of the Iberian Peninsula, and he wanted Rodrigo gone. So what did Julian do? He, of course, turned to Rodrigo's enemies, the Muslims in North Africa, and asked them to help him to get the throne from Rodrigo, from Al-Andalus, from the Iberian Peninsula, and even promised them to give them any secrets that he knows about the Iberian Peninsula, even giving them, supplying them with ships and equipment. So the Muslims, of course, accepted that. Tariq bin Ziyad was sent out with a small number of people of 7,000, just to find out if it's all true what Julian was talking about, if he didn't want to trap them, maybe. And alhamdulillah, indeed, it was true. And the Muslims arrived there, and Tariq bin Ziyad actually made a point out of this one. We are here, and these people want us to stay. So yes, we did promise Julian to get him the throne and to basically take Ceuta, which is the only enclave in North Africa and Morocco, which was not part of the Muslim Empire at that time. So he was the ruler of Ceuta, of the north of Morocco, and he promised to give it to them. Africa, basically. So that time Africa was more important than Europe. So the myth, the idea that the Muslims came to Al-Andalus, to Spain, to Portugal, to Europe, to conquer Europe and to Islamize the continent, all this is utter nonsense, because there was no interest in Europe, rather there was interest in Africa at that time. And it was a deal that they went into. Now, in the end, when they saw that the people of the Iberian Peninsula rather accepted the faith and became, and this whole place became Dar al-Islam, became an Islamic part of the world, they decided to stay, and they decided to help their brethren also further. Islam, within 11 years, they had reached already France, northern France, close to Paris, which is massive, massive. Again, within 11 years, if we look at the Iberian Peninsula, if we look at that part of the world, Portugal, Spain, the Iberian Peninsula, up to France, we see that it takes days to drive through by car. Now, within some years, they had conquered this entire place, up to France, up to Paris. 7-Eleven was the start, basically, of the establishment of Islam in Europe, and not only in the Iberian Peninsula, but into France as well. As I mentioned before, the period of Al-Andalus, geographically, it is the Iberian Peninsula, that was Portugal and Spain and Gibraltar, But the period of Al-Andalus chronologically starts in 711 and finishes in 1492. These are more than 700 years where the Muslims ruled not only in the Iberian Peninsula, but even up to Switzerland. Another fact that many people don't know, that the southern part of Switzerland, which is nowadays the French-speaking part of Switzerland, used to be part of the Muslim Empire, used to belong to the Muslims. There were Muslim, Swiss Muslim traders up there. They even traded up to the German border. And these are all facts that we can find nowadays in sources. Monasteries in Switzerland, for example, describe the fact that Muslims ruled the southern part of Switzerland for around 100 years, 70 to 100 years. What happened to these people in the end? What happened to them? How come you're telling us, wow, so many Muslims lived, ruled before, so many Muslims lived for more than 700 years in that part of the world. Where are these Muslims in Spain, in Portugal, in Switzerland, in Italy? Where are all these people? Now, simply what happened after the Christians started with their conquista, especially in Spain, but also in other parts of Europe, they basically got the Muslims, they were facing two alternatives. Either they became Christians, they left the deen, or they got killed. The third alternative was to basically leave the continent, leave their homes behind, leave the continent, leave Europe, and go, as many did, to either the other Muslim pole in the east of Europe, which became later a Muslim region, the Ottoman Empire in the Balkans, or North Africa, go to what is nowadays Morocco, Algeria, the North African region, basically. Many of them did it. Many Andalusis went to North Africa. Many Andalusis also went to the Ottoman Empire, and that gave the Ottoman Empire extra energy. We should not forget, we will look at this later, inshallah, that the Sultan of the Ottoman Empire later allowed Jews also to come and settle in the Ottoman Empire and develop the Constantinople, the city, which was destroyed basically due to a lot of fightings before and had to be rebuilt. And without Jewish traders, Jewish architects, but also Byzantine architects, it wouldn't have looked, the city wouldn't have been on the stage where it is now, the state that it has reached nowadays, mashallah. So we have to look into these things, the importance of these refugees, and nowadays we see the modernity nowadays, we see how we can follow it back to what's happening nowadays. Refugees are not necessarily a burden to an empire, to a country. In the contrary, actually, most of these refugees were welcome and they were needed to create the backbone, actually, of empires such as the Ottoman Empire. So on the one hand, of course, it was a terrible disaster that 1492, the last Muslim city, Granada, fell in Spain, and Portugal had already become, as a country, independent, a nation, a Christian nation, that actually had to look rather towards further west than towards east. Portugal was landlocked basically from Spain. It couldn't go further inside because Spain was still, Al-Andalus was a Muslim part of Europe. So the Portuguese had to look east, westwards towards the Americas and Africa. And they did that. So that's why Portugal was basically the first European empire, the first European nation that went out to discover the Americas as well as many parts in Africa for themselves, obviously, because what happened, Portugal had this chance and made use of the chance to basically go westwards, to go and create the biggest and most important country in South America, Brazil. Okay, the same, we should not forget that the Portuguese had the chance to go to Africa, and from Africa also, of course, to several countries in Asia, which became later Portuguese colonies. Many Portuguese, and as a nation, Portugal views this as the golden age. But the real golden age of the Iberian Peninsula of Al-Andalus was actually the time of Al-Andalus between 711 and 1492. The question, again, that many people ask me is like, what is this name? Where does this come from? What is Al-Andalus, actually? There are several ideas about this name, but the strongest reason for the name is most probably the people who were ruling there, another Germanic tribe actually ruling in that part of the world, were called Vandals. Vandals, we see already the connection, Al-Andalus, most probably. That is the strongest argument for the case of the name. Nowadays, the province that is called Andalusia, in the south of Spain, is just a province of the country of Spain. But Al-Andalus used to be basically all the way up to the north of Spain, including Septimania, the south of France, certain parts of France, southern region of France, up to even Tours and Poitiers, where the last, one of the battles took place in France. And they managed to stop the Muslims going further north. Why did they call the Muslims Moors? Very simple. They started the narrative, us and them, we European Christians against them African Muslims. Moors comes from the Greek word Mavros, which means black. So what they simply did, a white European Christian belongs to the continent, so these African invaders from outside, these black African Muslim invaders come to us, so they should go back to where they come from. But actually, this term Moor was not meant to be something good, it was actually rather negative. It remained until the 15th, 16th century very strongly in the minds of the Europeans. The Protestant Reformation, however, started going against it and started looking into the achievements of the Muslims in the Iberian Peninsula, in the rest of Europe. We should not forget that that time, the golden age of Europe, was actually that time that the Muslims of Al-Andalus established the first universities in Europe. It was not in Oxford and Cambridge, but it was in Cordoba, it was in Spain, what is now Spain and Portugal. We should not forget the influence that the Arabic language had and still has on the Spanish and Portuguese language. The translation of ancient sources by Aristotle, Platon, Sophocles, we would never be able, as Greeks, that we are so proud of, oh, mashallah, look what we have come up with, these great, great Greek philosophers, we would not even know them nowadays had the Muslims not translated them for the rest of Europe. And not only in Arabic, but also in Latin. So it's a massive, massive part of our history that we have to understand, and not only as Muslims, but also as Europeans, and as Muslim Europeans is even more so. Now, as we said before, the Al-Andalus as a part is not only geographical, but also chronological. And within the geography, in general, the Iberian Peninsula is part of Al-Andalus. That was the main part, it was called Al-Andalus. But during that time, Italy, and especially the island of Sicily, was ruled by the Muslims for around 250 years. And from there on, even if you look at history and historical facts, you will see that actually the Renaissance in Italy was influenced rather by the Muslims in Sicily than by the Muslims in Al-Andalus. But they all played a very big role, up to Switzerland, as we said before. Now, France, another example of France in the south, we all have heard of the troubadours, the culture of troubadours, the singing and the poetry that these troubadours actually developed. Now, if we look carefully back, this culture of the French troubadours developed during the time of the Muslims. When the Muslims were there, we should not forget, the Muslims came from a civilization, their background, the Arab Muslim, for example, from the Arabian Peninsula, even before Islam. The culture that they had was actually rather poetry. They were looking into poetry and they were very well-versed, and they had high civilization and high culture developed in with regards to poetry. And this poetry, this poetic element, this poetic culture went over to France, what is nowadays called the culture of the troubadours. Jazakumullah khair. We have come to an end of our first episode, and inshallah, see you in the next one. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
To find out more about the works of Dr. Steph Kerris, visit his website at www.stephkerris.com or follow him on social media at Dr. Steph Kerris.
If there is one thing that I enjoyed studying while I was at school or learning about was the Ottoman Empire. That I still have my book, but I don't have it with me. I told my sister to bring it for me when she's coming home, and it's just I don't know, I feel like I love the Ottoman Empire for some reason. Otherwise, this was very, very educative. This is the history that we're not even taught, and I don't know why. More reasons as to why you guys should like this video so others are able to see it and actually share it with your fellow friends. When it comes to the malls, I've seen this debate that goes on social media, and there was once actually on one comment, on one video I mean, where someone was talking about them. On Twitter, it was back and forth as to who the malls were actually. Someone says, no, they came from these Arabic countries and they went to Europe. But this video is clearly stating that it was through the religion of Islam that Muslims or Arabs came from this part of the world, the Middle East, to Africa. And it's then the Africans went to Europe, opened up to Europe, or I don't even know how I can phrase it. But then that's what's happening. To me, it really doesn't matter if it was the Arabs, if it was Africans, but they still went out there and with all the knowledge that they had and civilized these parts of Europe that have been spoken about, which is fine with me. Otherwise, this is a part of history that we never which were never taught in school, and this should be educational to us. Let me know what you think. Make sure to give this video a thumbs up, share it with your friends, and of course do not forget to subscribe, and I'll see you in my next reaction video.